All right, good afternoon. My name is Scott Aylor. I'm Corporate Vice President and General Manager of the Enterprise Business at AMD. I was super excited to have the opportunity to sit with Forrest Norrod, who runs our EESC team, as well as Kevin Lepak, our Senior Architect and Senior Fellow in charge of EPYC, to share with you a little bit about, you know, some of the questions that are out there about EPYC and what's going on in the community.
We've talked about what Infinity Fabric means as it relates to inter-processor communication on a package. What about inter-system and rack communication? How do we think about Infinity Fabric in that regard, as well as other capabilities that we have for rack-level communication?
Yeah, sure. So, yeah, so Infinity Fabric is really focused on our connectivity within, you know, our coherent domain, right? So within a given socket or across, you know, sockets in the 2P system, you know, it has the basic substrate logically is, you know, the same in both those cases. In some cases, the performance attributes are maybe a little bit different. Right, but in terms of, you know, how you can utilize it, it's the same. You know, we're not really focused on extending that, you know, outside of the system, but we are clearly very aware of all of the, you know, effort in the industry around industry standard, you know, out within the box, you know, advanced memory connectivity options or also system to system communication options. And we're a member of, you know, multiple industry standard consortia in that regard, right? And so we are, you know, actively involved in those things. You know, we aren't talking about them specifically, you know, about our product plans in that regard, you know, with EPYC specifically, but we're, you know, actively involved and engaged in that development in our forward-looking roadmap. Do you want to add any more?
Yeah, you know, I'll go a step beyond that, Scott. I think Kevin, you said it well. I mean, we're focused on Infinity Fabric as being an interconnect for the components that we provide, both within a piece of silicon, across pieces of silicon in a package, or between sockets or other pieces of AMD silicon. We're not looking to standardize Infinity Fabric or try to drive, you know, quite frankly, a proprietary standard, you know, more broadly into the market, or proprietary interface. I mean, we're really focused, and our members, as Kevin said, of C6, of Gen Z, and, you know, we think there's some great efforts underway to have industry standard coherent interconnects that will allow system designers to extend the systems in a standard way, and to allow others to add value and to innovate in an open ecosystem. And so that's really where our focus is. As Kevin said, we're not going to talk specifically about our product plans around those, but we're very strong supporters of both of those.
Great. Yep. Excellent. So, next question, you know, from the web is actually a bit of a specific one, but we'll try and give it a shot. So, there's a request for an unlocked EPYC, specifically a 7551P, that somebody would like to build a workstation for 3D modeling and simulation. So I think, first of all, right, I think super excited that there's interest in the 1P platform, right? I think that's one of the areas where we definitely see that, you know, people that buy, you know, kind of the bottom half of the stack from two socket systems today, 2650s and below, I think are great candidates for the one socket right. solution. And, you know, 3D modeling and simulation with what we're doing and the floating point results that we see, I think, is a great fit. The real question is unlocking, right? Are we unlocking? And Kevin, I'll kind of tee that up to you in terms of, you know, what are the capabilities that we offer today? And then how do we think about the needs of the enterprise market as it relates to things like unlocking
sure,
parts?
Sure, absolutely. Okay, so, you know, the existing EPYC product stack already has, you know, some configurable power features as part of it. We call it configurable TDP. And in our top infrastructure group, you know, we have multiple kind of bands of TDP, you know, in our different parts of the product stack. But in our top infrastructure group, it's rated as 180-watt product, but it can be configured up to 200 watts. So there's, you know, room for you to go to higher levels of performance, you know, even within that, you know, specific product, right? In other bands in the other infrastructure groups, you know, we have limited configuration up in some of the other bands and the configuration down, you know, for which isn't a particular focus in this workstation question, but it's a capability we have. As a rule, you know, when we're designing an enterprise class server processor, you know, the focus is really more on making sure that we can give a solid, repeatable, you know, product definition to those customers who are purchasing an enterprise class product. So we're a little bit less focused on, I'll call it, unlocking and overclocking style capabilities. So we don't really offer that currently in the EPYC product line, you know, but I went over some of the features that we do have, right, that might apply in that particular case. Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, you know, I think the other thing that I'd say is, look, the consequences of a failure, and maybe even a silent failure, I'm a gamer, in a gaming PC are pretty minor, right?
Other than the inconvenience. Yeah, other than the inconvenience. Losing.
Right. Yeah, that, if I get fragged, yeah, okay, right. But the consequences, particularly if it's a silent failure, which some of these things would tend to be, can be much larger if it's in a scientific computing or a modeling or certainly a server environment. So we've chosen to offer the extensibility that Kevin talked about, but still guaranteeing that, you know, the validity of the results, and we really wanted at all costs to avoid, you know, any customer inadvertently encountering a silent failure.
Yeah.
And so, trying to hit a balance. I mean, I think, you know, other products, you know, perhaps will in the future, certainly on the client side, I think we'll continue that unlocked strategy.
Yeah. So we give people flexibility with things like configurable TDP.
Right.
If they have infrastructure that can support, let's say, up to a couple hundred watts, they can run up to that level. But that staying within that reliable envelope is kind of what we've really designed for.
You know, the one other thing that I'll say, I'm not sure we've talked about this very much, is there also is, and I'll let Kevin talk about this a little bit more, we're also giving customers a choice on something we call the determinism slider. And so... the part can actually operate in two different modes, power determinism or performance determinism. And in performance determinism, you know, if you buy a SKU from us, you know, multiple instances of the same SKU will behave the same way. So if you get a certain level of performance, that's the, you know, under a certain set of conditions, that's what you're going to get from every different SKU. And, you know, that's very advantageous for some customers. And again, it gets back to predictability. For other customers, however, they want, you know, to get every last bit of performance out, and they don't care if there's minor variations because of manufacturing variations inherent in semiconductor processes. And so we've got the power determinism, which again protects the customer against going beyond a limit where results could be unpredictable, but lets each individual chip boost as much as it can against that limit. And Kevin, I don't know if you want to comment any more on that.
No, not too much. I mean, you hit the important points, Forrest. I think, you know, the maybe one thing that folks might find interesting is that in any of those modes, or one of the things technically underpinning it, right, is in each case, when we create the same OPM but out of different pieces of silicon, they're all very carefully...
OPM meaning model.
Yeah, right. Yeah. The model or SKU, yeah, some, yeah, people call it, right? Our term is OPM. But anyway, so when we bend the silicon, we know exactly how much voltage it needs to hit a certain frequency, and that's always optimized in every part.
Right.
Right. So when you're in that, what you call the performance determinism mode, we actually draw differing various levels of power, you know, in... I'll call it different products that are part of that same OPM because the silicon varies. So that's what gives us the flexibility. So we always optimize along both axes, you know, as much as we can, right? So even when you're in, you know, performance determinism mode, we're still running it at, you know, the lowest voltages that we deem safe, right? And it's independently optimized for every part. It's optimized at, you know, 25 megahertz granularity, right? We've talked about that in some other contexts, right? So that all underlies, you know, what you said, right, Forrest.
Yeah, and I think you guys hit on that, right? There's different use cases, right? Because there's, to your point, maybe you're in a search application or something that's kind of very, you know, critical where you don't necessarily care about repeatable results every time. You just want the result as fast as possible. Whereas if I'm a cloud provider and I'm offering a service and I want to offer a deterministic quality of service, that repeatability might be very important.
Yeah, you know, the other area where that's important, and this may be counterintuitive, is if you've got a large cluster where you're converging results, having predictability of the execution streams is important rather than having them dither. That can actually be counterproductive to performance. So having repeatability there can in a large cluster can be very important.
You know, to that point, what a great lead-in, right? The next question here is, you know, can we build 1,000 CPU supercomputers with EPYC? Yes, we like,
sure,
those quite a lot, right? We would
let's
like
to do it.
Let's build a bunch of those. I think, you know, I think the answer is yes. You know, I think the question here is very specifically around, you know, connecting via PCI Express. I think there's definitely different network topologies associated with building clusters and supercomputers. But I think, you know, in general, we've talked about the fact that, you know, our evolution of fabrics in the long term will be kind of around industry standards. Mm-hmm. I think the ability to connect, you know, via high-speed NIC cards, whether that's Ethernet or InfiniBand, we've worked quite closely with all of the partners in that area to ensure that we have broad capability to really build out clusters in that regard. There's another question here, and Kevin, this one may be for you. I'm not sure why we'd want to do this, but there's a question about could we put two different EPYC SKUs together in a two-socket system? So, for example, a 7251 and a 7301, right? That sounds like an interesting thing. Is it possible?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah. So that question comes up occasionally. I think the short answer is no. It's not our plan to be able to do that. You know, it's for a couple different reasons, but in a lot of cases, it just has to do with making sure that, you know, everybody gets what they expect, and it's a huge, you know, cross-platform validation matrix to try to enable it, right? For, in most cases, not a ton of value. I mean, we give you the whole feature set, you know, with all the parts that we offer. So, you know, versus some alternatives where the processors actually differ in terms of their basic functionality, right? Maybe it makes sense, but, you know, for what we, you know, for what we do, we don't see that as a particular need. You want to add anything there, Forrest?
No, you hit on it. I think, you know, you don't have to, buying a different SKU won't give you a different set of features, which you know, with EPYC. And just the validation matrix would just explode. And yeah. So I don't think there's no plans to do that.
Okay, cool. You know, next question that came up was one around third-party reviews, right? We've talked about, you know, we showed some benchmarks at the launch. People tend to want to have kind of an unbiased opinion, right? And what's the plan for third-party reviews? And I'll take that. So actually, I think we may even already have it posted in the Facebook live area. You know, we actually seeded several different, you know, EPYC systems to lead reviewers. And there's a lot of people that can kind of do benchmarks, but, you know, looking at the people that are qualified to really do kind of a good, strong server review, there's not that many. So we're very excited that, you know, Ian and Johan at Anontech kind of got first crack at a system and were able to publish some, you know, some pretty interesting results. I think, you know, looking at things not only from leveraging kind of proprietary compilers, but also more open source compilers, which tend to be more pervasive in the industry. Across a wide variety of benchmarks. So you all should be able to see in the Facebook Live area posts that kind of show links to that. Andreas Stiller at CT did a first look as well, where he published some of the work that he had done, comparing us to, I think, an 8180 from the competitor. And then finally, Patrick Kennedy at Serve the Home, STH, has also had a system, actually a Super Micro system, that he's been posting results on his YouTube channel. So I would say you're starting to see them, right? You're starting to see them come out and expect more in the future. And I think, you know, in general, I think we're encouraged by the results. Forrest, you want to think about, chat a little bit about what we're seeing?
Yeah, no, I think you know, we've been very gratified by what we've seen so far. And you know, one of the advantages of the third-party reviewers is they can lay their hands on a Skylake system before we can.
Yes.
You know, so, you know, one of the unfortunate things from my point of view about launching in Q2 is we were unable to run benchmarks against Skylake systems, of course, Skylake servers. You know, I think the data that we're seeing shows that our projections of where we would sit competitively, not just against Broadwell, but against Skylake, are pretty much in line. And I think it's pretty much in line with what we communicated at the launch. The Anontech results, I think, you know, generally show you know, the EPYC 7601 beating the Skylake part, the 8176, I think.
Yep, that's right.
Was what Anontech used. I think there were one or two where we were a little bit behind, but for most of them we were ahead, sometimes well ahead. And so I think that's been tremendously gratifying. And when you look at the relative price positioning as well of those two parts, both of which are very high in the bin. I think the Anontech used the second fastest Intel part, which is more than twice as expensive as the 7601. I think the results speak for themselves. I think they've been very good. Been yeah. very pleased.
No, I think again, kudos to the team that put all the work into that. So we very much appreciate
and
that.
And by the way, I think that also addresses, you know, back to this MCM question. I mean, the proof is in the pudding. You know, I think generally for the workloads that and benchmarks that customers are going to use, you know, Kevin and the team have delivered a fantastic part that we think, you know, has a lot of value. And for some workloads, I think really delivers substantially higher performance than Intel. Skylake's a good part, yep. Don't get me wrong. And there's certain workloads where they're going to do better than we. But there's others, and I think it's coming through in the non-tech results and others, where EPYC clearly has a lead, particularly in and I think most people didn't expect this, floating point. You know, Intel's making a big deal about AVX 512, which is a new feature that we do not support, but all of the floating point code written to date does not use AVX 3512, and the results on EPYC have been tremendous. On floating point head to head against a competitor,
and to that point, since we're on it, you know, this has been a point that's also come up is, you know, back to the design decision around kind of our floating point implementation, mm-hmm. right? Is we don't have as much vector width, but we've plumbed with dedicated pipes and had speed differences. It's now kind of starting to show, you know, in the benchmarks. Kevin, when you think about kind of that applicability of, you know, how do we think about the floating point implementation we have, the power and area trade-offs? Because we talked about this, right?
Yeah,
when we decided to kind of go down the path that we went down, how do you think a little bit about, you know, kind of what we've done with floating point versus kind of a very wide vector width kind of oriented machine?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, the way we, I mean, and you prefaced lots of this, right? I mean, to do a very wide, you know, vector implementation inside of a CPU is pretty expensive, right? It's expensive in area, it's expensive in power. You know, it's evidenced in, you know, turbo profiles, right? And it's been true in historical, you know, competitive products as well. And it's, you know, more exacerbated now than it's been in the past. But I think, you know, that's clear, you know, external evidence of the trade-off, right? That's why I brought it up. So, you know, we just said, you know, hey, our true value is in delivering, you know, a lot more bandwidth, right? We're very good at bandwidth-intensive HPC codes. Right, and that's been our hallmark for a long time. Like, we've continued that, and for things with very high compute intensity, right? You know, we have another, you know, strong portion of the company, basically our GPU and heterogeneous, and our compute, you know, part of our roadmap that suits that very well, right? So we, you know, we are less incentivized to put a strong focus on it in our CPU core roadmap and our x86, you know, CPU core roadmap, because the things with the very high compute density, we have something that's optimized really well for that already, you know, coming out of kind of the GPU arm of AMD, right? So I would say that's the way we've thought about the situation.
Yeah, and let me turn the contrast up on that one click further. I mean, I would go beyond that and say, look, for vectorizing, for code that's going to get vectorized and where you want to do explicit parallelism, the software work to expose the explicit parallelism, as Kevin says, we've got a great GPU that would takes that well beyond what you can do inside a CPU, and so we decided to optimize instead the floating point for more, you know, general purpose use, you know, and you know, having the four issue and having and the balance that we did, we think for the vast majority of floating point codes, particularly those that exist, and particularly for those for which you're not going to do the you know, the work for explicit parallelization, you know, EPYC's got a fantastic FPU, and I think that shows in the benchmark results from Anantec.
You know, on that point, you know, the next question that came through was a question / suggestion is, hey, why aren't you posting more benchmarks of spec CPU 2006? You've posted 7601, but none of the other CPUs. Is there a supply issue, benchmark delays? You know, I kind of wanted to point out is we've been in high volume production on the first four SKUs in the stack since our launch, right? So we launched with availability of over half the stack at launch. And I think the thing to look for in terms of benchmarks is the spec.org submissions that you see out there typically come from our partners, right? So I think Supermicro and HPE with their CL3150 published both 1P and 2P world records at the time, with 7601. So I would expect those things to be coming shortly, right? In terms of as they build out their portfolio with more SKUs, I think you'll see spec 2006 start to fill up with more and more AMD based scores.
We've also got spec 2017 coming out here as well. That was just released. And so I think you're also going to see from us and from Intel, I assume, as well, you know, spec 2017, you know, results coming out here, and that probably the focus of the industry shifting from 06 to 17.
Yeah, and that'll be a transition, right? Yeah. Kind of anytime you change the y-axis, people have to get recalibrated to what's
right,
good.
That's right.
So I think we expect that coming, and I think we're very active in it. You know, a few other questions here as it relates to ecosystem. You know, one of them that came up was VMware will release vSphere 6.5 update to support EPYC. Does this include enabling new EPYC security technology? Well, I think, you know, we shared, for those that maybe haven't followed us closely, we shared some kind of very new and innovative technologies around security, our ability to do secure boot, our ability to do secure memory encryption, and secure encrypted virtualization. Those are things that we shared actually at the launch event on June 20th. And security is a journey, right? There's things that come, you know, a long time, but I'm happy to say that, you know, today, you know, transparent, you know, secure memory encryption is enabled, right? So that first step in the journey is there. And I would say we've also been upstreaming a lot of these changes into the Linux community. Mm-hmm. We've actually been doing that for about a year.
Yeah.
So it's now gaining acceptance, right? So the different community members are now kind of accepting and approving those changes for upstream. So I think, you know, security's on the way, right, as it relates to things available now and today, but also some of the things that require a bit more kind of work from our partners are in flight as well. So I think we're in a reasonable place there.
You know, but Scott, I think, and I think it's important because we made this point at launch, you know, the work that you're talking about is absolutely required to enable all of these features, but it's work at the OS and hypervisor level. One of the things that we really focused on for all of these security features was, you know, to make them very easy to adopt. And what we thought that would require was, you know, zero impact to the application developers or to guys running the VMs. You know, that just impact to the OS and hypervisors, and that's where the focus has been.
Yeah, absolutely. So getting those foundations plumbed so that the application code doesn't need to change and it really is security you can use. So excellent. There's another security related question, you know, from the community is, when will you release PSP source code? So essentially kind of the embedded hypervisor and firmware that we run in kind of inside of our platform security coprocessor for those that maybe aren't as close to the technology. I think our approach, I'll kind of take this one and you guys can chime in as well. We've actually already completed multiple different audits of from security companies that we've hired to come in and essentially try and find threats vulnerabilities and our PSP architecture, as well as the PSP firmware that goes with it. So that's something that we actually completed actually earlier this year. So I think we are looking to have people look at our security implementation from a software perspective and determine if there are vulnerabilities and weaknesses. At this point, it isn't our plan to go kind of put that out in the community, but we are taking the right steps and measures to ensure that we are having people that are experts that kind of know what bad agents do. To really see if we have vulnerabilities.
Yeah, you know, so there's a third party audits that we've contracted, but quite frankly, we've also had some customers charter their own.
And yes.
So not just AMD, but other customers and partners have performed their own third party audits of our firmware as well.
Yep. Very good. The next questions really kind of pivot a little bit more to the hardware ecosystem. So there's kind of a grouping of questions of, hey, when can I get my hands on a Supermicro 1 socket? When will the Dell EMC server be in production? You know, a few kind of couple of points is it's really probably not our place. It's not our place to talk about kind of when our customers' products will be coming to market. You saw at the launch, you know, over 20 platforms available at launch and from a wide variety of partners, including Supermicro. You know, I would say in general, you saw at the launch, you know, broad applicability and availability across the enterprise portfolio in the second half of this year. So really, a lot of our energy at this point is now kind of lining up behind our customers' launches now that our technology has been made available. How do we make sure that they're building the right enterprise class systems? You know, whether it's Gen 10 with HPE or 14G with Ashley and the guys at Dell, how do we make sure that we're letting them build the best portfolios they can? So we're not going to be talking about kind of their availability. It's really kind of, you know, in balls in their court.
Yeah, but as you said, multiple customers did announce immediate availability, including some, obviously you mentioned Supermicro systems, and then it'll be building out strongly through the rest of the year.
Yes. Last question around availability, and seems like it then starts to pivot into some other topics is, you know, how long until Amazon and Microsoft or any other cloud providers use EPYC? I think, you know, similar answer, right? I think we talked about, you know, and showed on stage at the event, you know, with Corey Sanders from Microsoft, Li Chao from Baidu, talked clearly about their intention to deploy in second half of the year. And so I would say, in general, we're working very hard to make sure that those cloud companies meet their objective with us. So let's look at some other potential live questions. And again, I would invite folks, you know, in the Facebook Live area to respond with questions so that we can keep the dialogue going. Okay, here's an interesting one. Okay, now it starts getting really fun. All right, so there's two here. What do you plan to improve with the next variation of EPYC, right? This is probably an interesting one. That's a bit of futures, but let me kind of take a cut at that, and then you know, we can kind of go from there. Is I don't think that we're in the mode of kind of revealing our plans from a roadmap perspective, but I would say, you know, in general, it's very important, and we've shared this as part of the roadmap planning that we did share at Financial Analyst Day, that we need to be on a cadence of innovation. Right, that kind of comes to market when things, when the market is moving. And so the thing that we did talk about is that, you know, the next variation of EPYC will be platform compatible, right? So people that are building platforms with EPYC today, what was formerly known as Naples, will actually have socket compatible platforms for the future. So that means that they can take the investment they've made today and have kind of the virtues of what will come in the next generation. And I would expect, you know, attributes of that are performance, attributes of that are security, the things that we've done with OneSocket. These are all kind of multi-generational philosophies that I think you could see, you know, probably more of those things as we move into the future.
I think that's right. You know, the other thing that we said, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to step on you, Kevin. The other thing that we've said is that Rome will be implemented in 7 nanometer. And so, you know, we're very confident in that process and very confident that that'll meet that cadence that we talked about before. And with that, every time you do a node transition, what do you get? You get a rather dramatic improvement in density that allows you to put yet more features and capability into the part. And you get, nowadays, you get a rather dramatic reduction in power, which enables, again, more density, more features, maybe more effective frequency at a given power level. So, you know, those are the types of things that people should expect. And you know, we're going to continue pushing strongly on maintaining a very strong, highly performant solution, and so that people that engage with us today can be sure that their investment that they're making with us has legs.
Yeah, absolutely. And the only thing I was going to add is, you know, I mean, I'm here with y'all today talking about EPYC. You know, I spend a lot of time on the two products that we've talked about that follow it in this roadmap, right? So that's a significant investment for me personally and the rest of the engineering team, right, toward Rome and Milan, right? Yeah. So that work is absolutely, you know, proceeding at all available speed, right, as well.
Yep, very good.
Yeah, multiple independent. I mean, we've made a long-term commitment.
Yep.
And we knew coming back into this market that, you know, we had to deliver not just a leadership part, you know, really solid part with this first generation of EPYC. We had to deliver a long-term roadmap that people could have confidence in. And so we've made an enormous investment in independent hop, you know, leapfrogging design teams. So as Kevin said, I mean, most of your focus for a long time has been on Rome and Milan, and both of those teams are fully staffed and have been for quite some time.
Very good. A question related to it, so it circled back to around Infinity Fabric, right? Mm-hmm. And the question is a bit of, you know, Infinity Fabric, great scalability. Talk about latency in NUMA, right? So this is a good one that we've also seen a little bit on. And I think, you know, the thing that I would kind of tee it up, you know, is I think in general, you know, we see that, you know, the work that we're doing with a lot of the OS and hypervisor vendors around making sure that they are NUMA aware, I think is going very well. But Kevin, talk a little bit about, you know, the reality that is NUMA and kind of how pervasive it has been in the past and will be for the future.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, there's, you know, and I'm, you know, we want to talk most about what we're doing, but we'll broaden it out to just a generic, you know, computer architecture bias, right? So, you know, as the system, you know, gets larger and we want to deliver more and more functionality, right, which is, you know, a key thing that we're focused on at the platform level. I mean, when there's enough silicon in the socket to deliver that functionality, right, I mean, there's no choice but to have, you know, some form of locality domains, right? And you know, there's different engineering methods of approaching that, you know, that have different, say, cost scalability aspects and, you know, some performance scalability aspects and things like that. But there's really no getting around it, you know, in the fundamentals, right? So at some level, you know, we try the hardware perspective to, you know, I'll say flatten the system as well as we can, right? But the realities of, you know, semiconductors make that impossible to do at a large scale, right? So, I mean, the way that we, you know, approach that with EPYC, you know, we basically said we wanna tune the system, you know, for, I'll call it, common hypervisor VM sizes, things like that, which are, you know, a little bit smaller than our maximum configuration. So you get, you know, the benefit of the TCO optimization, you know, of the, you know, the large system scale platform, right? But our building block is kind of optimized at, I'll call it, a little bit smaller scale, you know, versus some alternative ways of having done that. And that gives us, you know, very leading interior cache latencies, for example, you know, and our latency to local memory is, you know, very competitive with any other way we could have done it. You know, when you cross the chip boundary, you know, you do take, you know, there is a step increase, you know, in the latency. We've tried to, you know, normalize it as best we can and provided plenty of extra bisection bandwidth in the system, you know, to give, you know, scalability, right? You know, regardless of how the memory gets laid out in practice, right? And that's kind of a conscious design choice that we made in how to approach it. I don't know if that's
I think it does, and I think it answers the question, because I think there's this, you know, this concept that NUMA's bad. Well, NUMA's been around for a long time, right? And even in monolithic implementations, there's, you know, if you look at kind of a single die, you have to think about locality of memory, right? And that. So I think the key, you know, that I see in this is that, you know, we've made conscious architectural decisions that drive a pretty tremendous performance result across a lot of, you know, kind of very relevant and high volume applications.
Yeah, you know, and I think one of the things we've tried to do is to leverage the work that's been done over the last 15 years for plumbing the ecosystem for NUMA domains. And so we've got essentially, you know, three layers of NUMA maximum in our system, which sort of corresponds to the maximum general practice that has been in the industry for a while. But it is a look. It is a, as Kevin said, it's a result of the laws of physics. You know, whether you're monolithic or you're multi-die, you are going to have affinities. You are going to, some cores are going to be closer to memory controllers, certain memory controllers, than others. And you see other guys talking about, you know, historically cluster on die topologies or even I think the terminology now is sub NUMA. You know, optimization, which looks a hell of a lot like NUMA optimization to me.
Yep.
But you know, so I think, look, it's just a reality. And I think the industry is aware of it and tuned for it. And most applications and most operating systems, you know, are very well aware and can take advantage of it. There are pathological workloads or you know, or older applications that may not, and they'll run just fine, but you know, they won't be as optimal.
Leave performance on the table.
Yeah, they leave performance on the table. Whereas, you know, if the application is NeMo aware, which most are, it'll take advantage of.
Well, and back to the multi-die thing for just a minute. So, you know, disregarding, you know, kind of, I'll call it system topological layout. You know, as we're increasing the platform-focused feature set, you know, the sockets and packages get bigger and bigger and bigger. They have to be to deliver the, you know, the external feature set that our customers demand, right? Yeah. So when you do that, there's more area available inside of the package than you can fill with a single monolithic die, right? So there's an opportunity there when you take a long-term view architecturally to say, given that reality, how do I best make use of that capability, right? So I think that's a, you know, maybe we're, you know, maybe a little ahead of the curve there, the way some people view it, but it's a good, it's a good long-term strategy as well, right?
That's a great point. I mean, if you think about it from that regard, and actually I hadn't thought about it quite that way before, but that's a good way to look at it. You know, the cavity of the package is a locality domain that, you know, the question is, how do you most, when you get to these 4,000 packages,
and like we did
how
with
do you most effectively
with Infinity Fabric between dies, you can do custom interconnects for that are lower power for short reach, like, and that's one of the things we've done, for example.
Yeah, you know, and by the way, I mean, I think this is going to be more and more a reality, and again, for reasons that, for multiple reasons, including, again, I like the way that you express it, and I think others have said as well, look, that's the direction they're taking as well. And you know, the 2020 and beyond time frame is essentially a multi-die approach to take advantage of all that real estate within the cavity.
Okay.
So I think we are ahead of the curve. Yeah. We're ahead of the curve.
There you go. Good. Hey, a couple of quick questions, and then people have asked us because there was a bit of audio challenge in the beginning to kind of revisit the first question. So Forrest gets a monologue again on that one.
Fantastic.
One question that I thought was good in here was talking about power efficiency, right? Mm-hmm. So the question specifically is, does EPYC stand out with Intel Xeon processors in terms of power efficiency, right? And again, I would point to some of, you know, the third party benchmarks that have been out there. So if you look in kind of Johan and Ian's review, I think, you know, looking at a few different workloads, I think we fare very well. The other area that I think we haven't really talked about, but I think is a pretty major advancement in power efficiency, is what we're doing with one socket. So when you think about the ability to take what, you know, is historically kind of two CPUs, mm-hmm. an I/O hub in Southbridge, mm-hmm. and the ability to have multiple different power rails and sockets and really collapse that, you know, we think that there's going to be a pretty strong, you know, kind of preference in kind of that portion of the market towards one socket.
You want to take the first bite of the apple?
No, go ahead for it.
Okay, all right. Well, I definitely agree. I think, you know, one socket, not duplicating the set of system interface resources, you know, allows you to, I think, you know, more efficiently deliver a given set of features, assuming it'll fit within the package, a given set of features. And I think that holds true. And we certainly expect, and I think some of the early numbers are proving true, a substantial power performance advantage by eliminating the duplication of resources that you would get in a two-socket system, the provisioning of those resources. I think that, you know, beyond that, I think the team's done a hell of a job on the power efficiency side. Some of the things that we've done with AVFS and, you know, tuning the voltage independently to every core, tuning the frequency voltage response curve individually to every darn core, you know, is what's really given us a tremendous, you know, tremendous power efficiency, we think, in the sweet spot of the frequency range of the part, and we think that's certainly, you know, our testing indicated that, and I think, you know, some of the third-party testing has been very gratifying to see.
And from a technical perspective, I wanted to just say a little bit more about one of the things you hit on for us, right? So we do have, you know, per-core voltage regulation in the EPYC processor, too. It's a linear regulator. right? But that allows us to also tune, you know, each core's input voltage based on, like you said, with ABFS or our technology that allows us to determine the voltage that every core really needs to operate at the voltage frequency curve that's programmed into the part. You know, we can actually lower the voltage on a per core basis to let them, you know, improve the total power efficiency, right? So we deliver, you know, voltage into the socket, and that's shared amongst everybody, at least on the core rail in that particular, you know, within that socket. But we do have a step of regulation internally to drop down from that, you know, to optimize our own power efficiency on a per core basis, even across dies and the MCM to improve our efficiency.
Yeah, and our modeling of that LDO architecture, I mean, it was a pretty substantial.
Oh, absolutely.
Just talking about what we could do is a pretty substantial advantage over what we thought we could do with more granular, less granular power domains.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have other advanced clock management, you know, mm-hmm. techniques, right, as well, that are a huge part of our power and power efficiency.
Yeah, one of the questions on the web was around how did you do the 128 lanes of PCI Express, and that's where kind of DLWM comes in, the ability to do link management. So I think, mm-hmm. you know, the key takeaway here is, I think, you know, getting to that power level is not kind of a silver bullet. It's a lot of knobs, and they all kind of are very, you know, very tailored to the architecture, very tailored to the workloads. And it takes that when you have a device of this complexity to be able to achieve that kind of result.
Yeah. Maybe just, you know, for another 30 seconds on that last point, because we haven't really hit it, right? So when the links are used, you know, as Infinity Fabric, right, between sockets, we do actively manage them, and we scavenge that power when it's not necessary, right? When PCI Express links are unused, so not connected in the platform, so no device is present, or you know, if they're managed down to a lower power state, you know, by the devices and other things, we can scavenge that power and give it to the CPUs as well, for example. And even the on-package Infinity Fabric links that are the customized MCM interface, it has its own, unique idle power characteristics, so it's not a scrambled interface. It has a unique termination scheme when we do that. And so it uses less power when it's idle, and we track that, right? And we can scavenge that power as well, right? So, you know, we have lots of, you know, features specific to the enterprise usage of this product around power management that deliver what you just said, Scott.
And just to untangle our terminology, scavenge meaning allow that power to be used to boost the core frequencies.
Yeah, thank you, Forrest. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Very good. Well, again, to recap, I wanted to go back to the first question because there was a few kind of audio difficulties. Is, you know, Forrest, we've talked a lot around it, you know, since we started, but just to double back on the strategic implications associated with our multi-die approach, right, is how do we think about, as we came back into the market, why the multi-die approach, and how do we think about that being kind of the right choice for EPYC moving forward?
Yeah, you know, so as we were thinking about coming back into the market, we clearly wanted to be able to provide a full range of performance from the very high end down to the bottom. We clearly also wanted to provide a uniform set of features from the top to bottom as well. And when we started looking at how to do that, we realized we had this crown jewel in Infinity Fabric, which we were using, you know, within the die to interconnect the logical units within the die, that extending that not just between the sockets, but between die in an MCM, would allow us the ability to, you know, scale up to that full capability, well, offer the full capability, full feature set from low to high, and to scale up to the performance realm, the leadership performance realm that we thought it was important that we have re-entering the market. All of those features and capability take a lot of silicon, and quite frankly, without breaking it into multiple die, there would be no way to you know, simultaneously solve that equation, offer all of those features, be able to afford it, you know, to offer them across the entire spectrum of SKUs or OPNs, as Kevin said, and you know, really offer that scalability. And so it was a very deliberate decision, enabled, quite frankly, by the Infinity Fabric. And, you know, bluntly, we think it is for many reasons, it's the direction the industry is going.
Very good. Well, again, I appreciate you doubling back to that one, Forrest. And thanks to all of our participants here on Facebook Live. I think the questions were excellent. Hopefully this was useful for you to get a little bit of a view as to some of the things that we think about as we're bringing EPYC back into the market. Let's keep the conversation going. So I'd invite you, for the things that you didn't get answered, feel free to continue to post them in the Facebook Live area. And we'll make sure that we keep that as an active dialogue beyond this conversation, and make sure that we follow up and let you know more about the progress that we're making. So thanks very much, and have a good rest of your day.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.